Let's start. Thanks a lot for coming. It happened, I'm Sergei Ushakin, I'm director of the program in Russian and Eurasian Studies, which together with the Woodrow Wilson School co-sponsored this talk. And it's my great pleasure to introduce our speaker today, Sergei Guriev, who is visiting professor of economics at Sciences Po in Paris. Sergei originally was trained at the Moscow Institute of Physics and Technology in Sciences, but then decided to change his intellectual trajectory and became an economist. So he defended two dissertations and published widely in leading economic journals. He has multiple awards and prizes from Russian and international companies and associations that recognized his leadership and managerial skills and achievements. In addition to his academic career, Sergei is a member of multiple advisory boards and councils. I just name a few. Sergei is a board member of Sberbank, which is the biggest bank in Russia. He's also a member, he was also a member of the Council on Science, Technology, and Education that advised the president of Russia. Currently, he's on the academic advisory board of the Blavatnik School of Government at Oxford University. For almost 10 years, Sergei Guriev was the president of the new economic school in Russia, perhaps the best institution in the field of economic studies in the post-Soviet world. And today he will be talking about the political origin and implications of Russian economic slowdown. But before we start this, I really want to thank Alek Itzhaki, who was really instrumental in organizing this talk and bringing Sergei here. Thank you. So Sergei will be talking for about 30, 35 minutes, and then the floor would be open for all kinds of questions you might have.
Thank you very much, Sergei. This is a big pleasure and honor to speak here. Actually, 10 years ago, I remember I was teaching exactly in the same room in development economics, and I met one of my students who's now on the faculty of Princeton Economics Department, teaching exactly development economics, and it's bringing very warm memories. I will talk about Russia today. I will mostly talk about origins of slowdown, but this slowdown has so important political implications that eventually I will also talk about the implications of what's going on. And this is the graph which shows growth rates of Russian GDP, and it shows that Russian economy, which used to grow at 7 or 8% before the crisis, then recovered to pre-crisis level and started to grow at 4%. And only recently, in the last year or year and a half, it was dramatically slowed down to the growth rates of 1 or 1.5%. And I should say that this fact has not been easily recognized both inside and outside of Russia. So this is, for example, the forecast for year 2013 GDP growth done by IMF. This is kind of the leading macroeconomic forecast publication, World Economic Outlook. It's published twice a year. So this is a forecast for 2013 made in 2009, then the forecast for 2013 made in 2010, forecast made in 2011. And you see that always this forecast was about 4%, 3.5%, and only in the end of 2013, the forecast for 2013 went down to 1.5%. Similar learning curve was in Russia itself. So as recently as May 2012, President Putin, who came back as president once again, issued a decree, and actually a set of decrees and a number of electoral promises, which foresaw the growth of productivity, GDP per worker, of 6% a year for many years to come. In January 2013, Prime Minister Medvedev said that the disappointing numbers of 3.5 or 4% are too low, and Russia should be growing in the long run of 5% a year. That was just a year ago. And only in April 2013, Russian bureaucrats started to talk about the slowdown and started to warn about the slowdown actually being quite drastic. And also, what is important, in October 2013, Russian Minister of Economy Alexei Ulyukayev actually said that it is not unlikely that Russia will be stuck in stagnation mode for a while, actually for 20 years, that's his words. And finally, last month, Russian official statistics agency came up with the official number, which is 1.3% of GDP growth in 2013. It is not unexpected. I should say that if you watched the data in the short-term forecast, you could see that the slowdown actually started in 2012. I'll try to provide a rational explanation of that. I should also say that this is something which is not rocket science. We, together with colleagues in the US and in Russia, and together with my co-author Oleg Tsivinsky, put together a number of articles in a book called Russia After Global Economic Crisis, where we said that actually it is not unlikely that Russia will end up with what's called 70-80 scenario and become something like Brezhnevist stagnation economy. The same was done a bit later in Davos. World Economic Forum put together a big project on scenarios for Russia. These were presented in the Davos last year in January 2013. And these scenarios actually were quite pessimistic about Russian economic performance. So today I will talk about the origins of the slowdown, and I will mostly be going through alternative explanations of why this slowdown has happened. And I will also talk about political implication of the slowdown. There, I have much less to say, but I will speculate about what may or may not happen in Russia in the future. So this is the tree of explanations of the slowdown. So some people would say the slowdown is cyclical. Some people would say it's actually structural. Structural may mean that it's coming from the outside or it's coming from inside. And I'll go through those explanations and end up with those which I think are more plausible. Okay. So cyclical slowdown is something that you can easily relate to a first-year macroeconomic textbook. So if Russia has a cyclical aggregate demand problem, then it should have high unemployment, it should have tight credit, households should save rather than spend. And also, we know that central banks in countries like that should fight deflation, not inflation. Okay? None of that you can observe in Russia. We can actually see that unemployment is as low as ever. It's about 5%. In Russia, where unemployment benefits are low, 5% is actually probably already a low level. Actually, there are some regions of Russia where unemployment is zero. So, for example, in Moscow, unemployment is officially less than 0.5%, given the quality of measurement of unemployment in Russia, it probably means there is no unemployment at all. Inflation is also low. Inflation is lower than ever, yet it is still above the targets, and the central bank still doesn't manage to bring inflation within the target. I hope it will be happening this year, but still officially, inflation is a problem, and the central bank is very unhappy about inflation being outside of the target. The target is 6%, which by international standards is, of course, very high. Now, consumption is not slowing down. Consumption is still growing. Households borrow a lot. Household lending went up by 40% in nominal rubles in 2012 and by another 30% in 2013. Now, the stock of consumer lending is not as high if you compare internationally. But once you look at non-mortgage loans, once you cut out the mortgages, which in Russia are still very low, non-mortgage lending is now, the stock of non-mortgage household loans is 8 trillion rubles or 14% of GDP, which is not that low. It is now comparable not only to Central and Eastern Europe, but it's also comparable to Western Europe and not much lower than in the US. And in that sense, nobody can come out and say households save. No, households borrow. Households borrow and they prefer to spend. And people who would say that firms have hard time to borrow and there is a credit crunch would also be surprised to see that interest rates, once you calculate real interest rates subtracting inflation, you would see that interest rates are also quite low and are not rising. Now, the cyclical explanation is probably not consistent with the data, so I'll go to the structural. And first I'll look at the external. So there are two versions of external problems. One version is there is a global conspiracy against Russia, which hurts people who want to invest in Russia. These people are misinformed by the likes of Wall Street Journal and the Financial Times. And the other one is vice versa. The rest of the world is actually not strong but weak, and that's why Russian exports suffer, and that's why Russian economy is not growing. So that explanation is was probably true a couple of years ago, maybe certainly true in 2009, but actually if you look at data now, other emerging markets are not growing fast as before the crisis, but they're not really slowing down as rapidly as the Russian economy. Also, the global economy continues to grow at 3% per year, and it is actually quite unusual for President Putin to have Russian economy growing slower than the global economy in general. And of course, developed economies are also growing, which shows in high oil prices. Oil prices are not going down. They're at the levels which, if you look at the real prices, in annual terms, last couple of years were the highest in history, well, at least in 20th century and 21st century, the last couple of years where oil prices were above the previous episodes. That was, of course, an episode of summer 2008 when oil prices shot to $140 per barrel, but that was just a couple of months. In average annual terms, these are the best times for being an oil exporter. I should add a caveat. Gas prices are low, metal prices are low, but oil is definitely the most important export commodity in Russia, and oil is doing well. That's probably because global economy is also doing well. So how about anti-Russia conspiracy? So that is especially hot topic given the Sochi Olympics and all this debate whether Sochi Olympic stadiums are built well and in an efficient way. And the argument there is and this is put very clearly, and I will use this quote from Mr. Peskov, the press secretary of Mr. Putin, who said there is a disinformation campaign against Russia, and it is because nobody likes those who are healthy, wealthy, successful, and so on. And hence the negative information campaign. Disproving the conspiracy theory is impossible, but I've not seen any tangible trace of coordinated negative campaign. Moreover, we see that in Sochi, expectations actually were much lower than reality, and so athletes and journalists who come to Sochi, if anything, are launching a positive campaign, saying things are not as bad as we thought. But most importantly, and that's important for my economic analysis, is that even if there is a misinformation campaign, even if you cannot find anything positive in The Economist or Financial Times or Wall Street Journal, it is certainly not the foreigners who are responsible for taking money out of Russia. It is the Russians. Russians are taking more money out of Russia than foreigners bring in. And these Russians don't read Financial Times, don't read Wall Street Journal, and still they take money out of Russia. Okay, so maybe there is a conspiracy, but I cannot prove or disprove it. Okay? So let's go to internal problems. Now, the good news is here is I'm not alone. Mr. Putin, given the State of the Federation address to the parliament, also said that problems are internal. It is different from his previous speeches, but at least recently he started to adopt this debate, that discourse that problems are actually internal, and that is what causes slowdown. Now, you can think about problems due to macroeconomic populist irresponsible policies, but this is not the case. So debt to GDP ratio in Russia is 10%. It's much lower than developed countries, much lower than other emerging countries. Budget is balanced. Yes, it's balanced at this very high oil price, and still it is balanced. And moreover, there is a fiscal rule in place which says that when oil price will go down, budget spending will also have to go down. Whether commitment to fiscal rule will actually survive for several years, we don't know. But at least now, it actually functions. On top of that, even though central bank has failed to bring inflation within the target, central bank does reconfirm its mandate to fight inflation rather than do other things. And also it announced that in 2015 it will move to inflation targeting. And actually, for what it what it's worth, central bank is succeeding at least to lowering inflation, if not if bringing to it within the targets. So I would say that this is probably not true. And so that brings us to the more fundamental issues. So for some reason, doing business in Russia is not good. Is not profitable. Is not something that businessmen like to do. And that could be driven by two things. One is kind of long-term economic fundamentals, and another one would be governance problems. So, for example, if Russia has bad location, bad climate, snow emergencies every couple of weeks, if it has bad human capital, it has lack of resources, you would say it's not a place to do business, right? This explanation has a problem. What is the problem? Climate has not changed in the recent few years, in Russia at least. And also, geographical position has not changed. Russia has, some people would say that recognition of South Ossetia and Abkhazia did expand Russia's borders, but that is not very important. And in any event, so there is not a big deal. Resources, Russia does have sovereign wealth fund, Russia has a reserve fund, so Russia can afford simply to give Ukraine $15 billion just on the spot. These are things which are not characterized by a lack of fungible resources. And I, for the sake of time, to leave time for your questions, I will actually not go through all these arguments. I can talk about education a lot. I can tell you I'm not the person to defend Russian education, but I should say things are not as bad as they are sometimes portrayed. And that is especially true at the primary and secondary level, where Russian kids are actually competitive, pretty competitive internationally. They are not as good as, this Russian schools are not as good as Finnish schools or Singaporean schools, but still Russian PISA scores are improving. Russian PIRLS scores are actually very high. Russian kids can read very well. Higher education, there is a problem of quality, there is no problem of quantity. Actually, if you calculate the number of years of university education per person, Russians on average outperform Americans in every country in the world, and this is especially true for young Russians. And so Russia has per capita more higher education than US, New Zealand, and actually, for that matter, all other countries in the world. So there are problems with quality. Russian universities are not internationally competitive, but it's not like Russia doesn't have higher education at all. Now, on demographics, again, things are not as bad as they're portrayed. They're bad. Russian men don't live long, but they live much longer than, say, 10 years ago. They still live shorter by about 6 or 8 years than men in comparable countries. Russian women live as long as women in comparable countries. But the trend is actually quite positive. There is, of course, a problem of aging and shrinking population. Shrinking is not that bad. So this is the official forecast for the next 20 years, which kind of gives you an estimate of Russian population shrinking by about 1% over the next 20 years. Not 1% a year, but 1% in the next 20 years. This forecast includes 300,000 net immigrants every year. That may be a conservative or optimistic forecast, but that's a different story. In any event, we are not talking about really bad population shrinkage. Aging is a problem. Number of senior citizens per worker will grow from 37% today to 50%, 52% in 20 years, but this is kind of a problem which we, of course, observe in every country, in every industrialized country. That, of course, is a big problem for pension system, but this is not something unusual. So that brings me to the issue of governance, rule of law, corruption, expropriation by the government or by politically connected competitors. And that kind of puts together a very consistent picture of why slowdown has started now. So you would think that there was fast growth before. Corruption was still high, but fast growth was coming from other sources, cheap labor, growing commodity prices, not just high, but growing commodity prices, from unused capacity when Mr. Putin came to power. in 1999, there was a lot of production capacity that was not used. So these sources of growth are exhausted. And for new growth, you need investment, you need increase in productivity, for which you need protection of investors and good rule of law. And this is exactly what Russia doesn't have. You can look at whatever governance indicators you want. I will just put corruption here, but if you look at other governance indicators, you would see a different, the same picture. This picture is actually very important because sometimes Russian government officials would say, and I heard that myself, to my questions, Mr. Putin or Mr. Medvedev would answer exactly in the same way. They would say other countries also have corruption. It's not only our problem. Sometimes they would add, Russia is a young country. In New Zealand, there was also corruption. In the US, 100 years ago, there was a lot of corruption. Sweden was a corrupt country 100 years ago. And the answer to that is this diagram, which shows, don't compare Russia to New Zealand. Compare Russia to countries with a similar level of development. Poland, Slovenia, Czech Republic, Croatia, Bulgaria, Brazil. These countries are way better in terms of control of corruption. And moreover, Russia's corruption level is, of course, better than Venezuela, but it is actually comparable to countries which are very, very poor and underdeveloped. And that should worry everybody who thinks about governance issues in Russia. And people do recognize these problems and take money out of the country. Now, the decade before 2008, 2009 was characterized by capital inflow. And even though oil prices were lower than now, capital was coming to Russia, not leaving Russia. And during the crisis, many things have happened, but after the crisis, capital continued to flow in until the fall of 2010. In fall 2010, money started to leave Russia again, and that continued at a very high rate, 4% of GDP, 3% of GDP. That's a lot of money, given that investment rate in Russia is 20% of GDP, 21, 22% of GDP. Initially, there was no worry. People said, President Medvedev fired Moscow Mayor Yuri Lushkov. He's left the country. His wife left the country, so they're taking their money out. So probably that explains the capital outflow. But after a couple of months, when the net capital outflow was in the range of $15 or $20 billion, people started to say, well, maybe even Moscow Mayor's wife is not that rich. As you see, there are ups and downs in capital outflow. There is seasonality, but it is going on and on. And initially, as I said, people thought that's Mr. Lushkov and Madame Baturina, his wife. Then people said, well, it's 2011. What do you want? The elections are next year. There is political instability. We don't know what's going to happen. And then in 2012, it turned out that investors are afraid of political stability even more than of political instability. And the reason for that is that apparently the political equilibrium is such that investors are not protected. And that actually, this diagram, which shows the composition of Russian GDP, suggests that the slowdown is indeed because of investment and investment climate. So as I said, consumption continued to grow, probably funded by financial development. But if you actually look at investment, which is this line, here, investment started to stagnate and actually fell in 2013 and is still below 2008 peak in real rubles. So that should give an indication that maybe investors like or dislike political system in Russia or whatever other issues they have, but they definitely vote with their feet away from Russia. And one other graph which shows what's going on with the stock market, for example, is also important. Russian stock market now trades at 60% of pre-crisis peak. As you know, other stock markets actually trade above pre-crisis peak. And if you look at the what's called multiples, price per earnings, so valuation of companies over their annual net profit. Russian companies trade at about 5 or 6. Gazprom actually trades at about 2.5, while emerging markets on average trade at 12, and developed markets trade at 16. So in that sense, investors think that there is something wrong in Russia which should be reflected in the stock market prices. And Sergey mentioned I'm a board member of Sberbank. Sberbank internally has this joke that Sberbank would be valued at double today's price if it had a different headquarters address. So, and that's actually what analysts in the stock market say as well. So does government know how to deal with that? The good news is yes. The bad news is yes. But the good news is yes, because these programs, reform programs, have been written many times by the very same government. Again, interestingly, people who are now running Russia are the very same people who've been running Russia 10 years ago and 14 years ago. And many government experts, independent experts, have provided a lot of advice what needs to be done. A lot of this advice went into President Putin's electoral, programmatic electoral promise article, economic plan article, we need a new economy. And then in a special decree he signed on the day when he came to office in May 2012. And some things have been done. Not to take too much of your time, I will not go through this. Some things have been done. Many things have been delayed or forgotten or kicked out. And another thing, which I don't want to sound too negative, I would like to say that Russia is not just one bad investment country, bad investment climate country. There are different regions. And actually, if you talk to foreign investors, some foreign investors will tell you, Russia's a great country in my region where I invest, where my plant is, governor likes us, and everything is fine. And this is, of course, a selection bias or survivorship bias, because investors, foreign investors, know which regions to go to, and they go to better regions. Okay? And now the bad news is government does know what to do and doesn't do that. Why? The only explanation is it doesn't want to do it. And it's a little bit like in Soviet jokes where everybody understands everything, but nobody does anything. It's a little bit like in a Soviet joke where a dissident runs around the Red Square and hands out blank flyers. And when KGB men detained him, he says, why should I write anything on the flyers? Everybody understands what's going on anyway. So no need to write anything. And that brings us actually to an interesting parallel, another interesting parallel with the Soviet times. In 70s and 80s of the last century, Soviet economy was stagnating. And this is why we call this scenario 70-80s scenario. At that point when we wrote this scenario in 2009, oil was at $40 per barrel, and we thought, well, at some point oil price will probably recover to $70-$80 per barrel, and we had this beautiful pond that would be 70-80 scenarios where oil price is 70-80 and life is like in 1970s, 1980s. But the reality turned out to be different. Oil prices actually went even further higher. But markets still kind of think about Russian government as a Brezhnev government. Markets actually price in zero reform. Markets price in no improvement in investment climate. Why is that? Because it's a political equilibrium. Status quo is not just an outlier, it's a reasonably stable political equilibrium. You would say all governments should be interested in growing the GDP, growing the pie. Nobody should like stagnation. Why wouldn't government do something that would increase the total pie? If the total pie is bigger than the current elite, would actually have a piece in the bigger pie. Why not? And the answer to that is, if to grow the pie, you need to do something that would reduce the probability that you will be able to cut your piece, then you would prefer a bigger piece and a smaller pie to whatever zero piece in a bigger pie, right? And in that sense, it's not surprising that government doesn't want to do things which would contradict its source of its political support, its political constituency, which are in place of inefficient state companies and corrupt bureaucrats and politically connected businessmen. And of course, this is something that I don't know, people in economics, political science know very well, but on more ordinary people, more ordinary level, whenever I talk to anybody about government fighting corruption, everybody says, how government can fight corruption if government is corruption? And the response is, whenever you're on a diet, you're actually fighting against yourself, right? You are told you need to reduce your cholesterol, you need to reduce your excess weight, and it's always about losing bits and pieces of yourself. It's actually, this is your kilograms, pieces of yourself you're effectively losing, but it's hard. Not everybody succeeds in that. Right. And in that sense, it's not going to be easy, and looks like both the government and the market believe it's not going to happen. Okay. And in that sense, this is a stable political equilibrium. Now, I will not talk about what should be done, how we will know if this equilibrium is changing. If you have questions, I can talk about specifics. But let me talk briefly in 5 minutes about political implications of the stable, no reform, stagnation, slowdown equilibrium. One big problem with the slowdown is that if you open Putin's electoral promises in 2012, this is kind of Putin 2.0, more like Putin 4.0, of course, but it was sold as a Putin 2.0 when Putin came back in May 2012. He promised many things, including raising pensions, raising salaries of doctors and teachers, raising salaries of policemen and soldiers. All of that is based on a scenario where economy is growing at 5 or 6%, not 1%. And in that sense, government will need to think about how do we stay in power, even though everybody would know that we have not delivered on the promises. And the growth has stopped and people will be unhappy. There are two ways to address this problem. One is to borrow. Russian debt is low. And this is what the Soviet Union actually did and eventually ran out of cash. This is the way which goes nowhere, because eventually at the episode when oil price goes down, it will turn out that Russia doesn't have reserves to face this crisis like it happened in 2008, 2009, when Russia did have reserves and political system did not collapse, even though oil price went down a lot. And in that sense, borrowing is a problematic way, and also is similar to what has happened to Brezhnev and Gorbachev, and Putin doesn't want to be Gorbachev. And I don't know whether you know about this or not, but within Russia, Gorbachev is not perceived to be a successful political leader, and especially by Putin. And another way is actually intensifying repression, so making unhappy people isolated and rounded up. Another way is to invest more in media and propaganda, and I would say that this regime is actually very masterful in using media and propaganda. They are not original, they learned it from Berlusconi, but they went far beyond Berlusconi in doing what they're doing. And of course, some partial reforms. And what will happen exactly, I don't know. I think it will be a combination of those. We see that this government doesn't want to step down. We see that this government doesn't want to do reforms which will endanger it. But what the combination of all these things will be undertaken, I really don't know. But something will have to happen, because it is 1% growth, not 5 or 6% percent growth. Now, what to give you some optimistic ending, in the long run, I'm very optimistic about Russia, exactly because that all economic fundamentals are actually quite good. And the problems are on the governance side. Governance is not easy to improve, but it's possible to improve, and some other countries have managed to do that. Also, compared to 20 years ago, when the whole elite was raised in Soviet Union, Russia didn't have a diaspora. Russian leaders actually came either from Communist Party or from Komsomol. Today, there is a generation of people with international experience, people who live abroad and can come back, people who work in Western companies in Russia. And some of these people actually have good education and also, what is very important, meritocratic values. So in that sense, this transition will not be as painful, because there will be a lot of people who know what to do. In the short run, situation is going to be much more uncertain. The change will either happen peacefully or not so peacefully. I should say that history doesn't give us many relevant examples simply because this democratization will be democratization of a country with very high education level and very high GDP per capita. So today's purchasing power parity GDP per capita is more than $20,000. This is a very developed country in that sense. And never a country as rich as educated moved from dictatorship to democracy. Maybe Saudi Arabia will move to democracy sooner than Russia, but I would rather bet my money on Russia moving sooner. And especially what is true is if you look at Moscow, and apparently political change will happen in Moscow. Moscow is already a very rich, developed, and educated place. GDP per capita in Moscow is something like in Italy or Spain. So will that be turbulent? We don't know. Also, it is not unlikely that transition will happen when the government will run out of cash. That will probably happen when oil price is low. So the new government will come in without reserves, with high debt, and with very bad terms of trade, with very low oil prices. So it's not going to be easy. So in that sense, I think in the short run and the medium run, even if the change happens, it's not going to be clear whether it's going to be nice and sweet and soft. So let me conclude here. I would say that slowdown is quite real. I think out of all alternative explanations, I would bet my money, I would prefer to stick to the explanation that the problems are due to political incentives of the elite, which is not interested in things that could promote growth, but are interested in things which will keep the government in power. And implications are much more uncertain because there are various tools, and these tools will take Russia in opposite directions. So there are tools related to reforms, and there are tools related to repression, and both carry a lot of risk for the government, and how exactly the government will act, we don't know. And one other important problem with Russia is that the government is very deeply misinformed, in the sense that censorship and propaganda eventually backfire because the government itself loses track of what's going on in the society and economy. And in that sense, it may actually make steps that for us from the outside would look as irrational. But for people within their information sets, like Mr. Putin today, that would make a lot of sense because they have their own information sources, which may or may not be relevant and truthful. So I will stop here and we'll be happy to take your questions.
So just raise your hand so that I
would
have some
thank you. Absolutely fascinating presentation. I had two questions. One is sort of technical one. This capital flight story is really fascinating. And you can treat it, and you do indeed treat it as a kind of political vote of confidence, political barometer. So I wondered whether there are any event studies, because your quarterly figures have a big variation. And so the first quarter of 2012 and the second, and the first quarter of 2013 are very big on your figures. Can you lead us a bit through that, and is it, for instance, something external? Could it be the Cyprus story in 2013 that has a big impact on capital flight? And then my second one was a more general one. When you're thinking about democracy, people often look to what's going on elsewhere. And I wondered how much of the debate is at the moment being read, as it were, through a Ukrainian lens, and how much Ukraine looks like a laboratory for what might or might not happen in Russia.
Thank you very much. Two very, very good questions. So on a capital flight story, it's always very hard to figure that out because it's not daily data. Eventually, these deals take time. And for example, in the beginning of 2013, there were two important events. One was Cyprus, which was supposed actually to bring money back to Russia because Russians got a very heavy haircut. They lost a scalp or maybe even half the head, some of them. But On top of that, there was a deal between Rosneft and BP and TNK, which actually took something like $30 billion in cash out of Russia. And you would say it's a technical adjustment, but think about it. Russian oligarchs who made all their wealth in Russia sold this oil company to Rosneft, got $30 billion. They asked Rosneft to pay them abroad. They didn't want to invest this money in Russia. And these are people who have been very successful in Russia, who know how to do business in Russia, and yet they want this money to be outside Russia. They're thinking about investing everywhere else, but not in Russia. So every dollar is a vote of no confidence. Every dollar leaving Russia is a vote of no confidence. Especially, not now, but especially in 2012 and 2013, well, 2012, when Russian economy was still kind of growing at 3 or 4%, and Europe was in a very bad mess, and still people would take money out of Russia to Europe. And from within Russia, Europe looked even worse, because propaganda was emphasizing that Europe is not going to survive, Europe is really a bad mess, and yet the very same bureaucrats who told that publicly would take their money out of Russia to Europe. So it's very hard to figure out events, how it works with event studies. I showed you the stock prices, but let me just give you an example. There is a very successful, very risky Russian company called TKS, which is kind of a hybrid between a bank and an IT company. And it's traded as an IT company in London, actually. This is an online bank, essentially. And so this bank is based on the model where credit cards are delivered by mail, basically. And once Russian Duma said, we will prepare a law that credit cards can only be delivered by in person. And of course, you can see the event study the very same day the company lost 40%. Of capitalization. So these events you can see, but events on capital flight, I just told you about Mayor of Moscow, it's actually very hard to figure out what's going on. Then there are some tax changes, but again, with taxes in Russia, until the very end, you don't know how likely it is that taxes will actually be changed or the change will be reversed, and the market always prices in some probability of that. On your second question about Ukraine, I think it's very, very important. These events are indeed a laboratory for Russia. I mentioned that, for example, Russia has high corruption. There is a very important argument. For example, many Russians look at Georgia. Georgia was always a more corrupt country than Russia before the reforms of the last 10 years, when it actually improved a lot. And many Russians are saying, you are telling us Russia cannot improve. You are telling us Russia will always be corrupt. Look at Georgia. And same as with Ukraine. And that actually gives Mr. Putin a lot of worries, because he sees that people can take to the street and affect politics in a very direct way. And that's why I think people outside of Russia underestimate the willingness of Mr. Putin to fight until the very end in Ukraine. Because Ukrainians are giving a very bad example to Russians. That going to the street may actually help. So I think we don't know what's going to happen in Ukraine, but it's a very important example.
Just to follow up on capital flight, two questions. I'm aware that in the last years of the Yeltsin presidency, and even the first couple of years, the Ministry of Finance is very focused on capital flight. So it's not just a 2010 and forward.
No.
It would be interesting if your chart were extended back, and I think you might find, that there was significant capital flight in it, and in effect, it went down for a bit during the first Putin term when people had a sense. So that's one thing. The second thing, my sense that the Ministry of Finance at the time had a very difficult problem in actually measuring capital flight, because so much of it was round trip. And it was via Cyprus. And it's hard to say whether return of capital through this device in the Cyprus vehicle for treaty breach?
Yeah, very good question. So the first question about 1990s, yes, it was persistent and high capital flight. It was due to many problems, including macroeconomic problems. At that point, Russian macroeconomic stability was always in question and eventually ended up in the devaluation and default of 1998. Investors who anticipated that default were correct. And so I won't defend the Ministry of Finance of that time. And you're right, in first Putin's years, there was capital inflow, and until the very crisis of 2008, it was a sizable inflow. Now, the numbers I showed are net capital outflow. So if you take your money out and bring them back through Cyprus, my numbers would count it as zero. So what I'm saying is more Russians are taking money out and keep them there than bringing back. And this is now a reasonably easy exercise to do because we know now the imports and exports. There are some games with undervaluing exports, so to keep some money out. But in principle, now it's completely legal to take your money out of Russia. So there is not a big deal with underreporting. And also we know how much comes in to Russia and how much is taken out by central bank as a reserve. So we, I think in a sense, we can trust the net data. So it is tight, and so it's up to the government to decide who is going to suffer. And the government can do a lot of things. The government can take money from teachers and give it to doctors, take money from one region to give it to another one, spend more money on Sochi and less money on Vladivostok. This is exactly what the government is doing. My perception is that government understands all these problems and will spend more on those who are more politically troublesome. And for example, one of the debates is the pension system, and government is really scared of pensioners, first voting against the government, and second, taking it to the street. Because shooting students is easy, and shooting pensioners is not easy. Okay? And in that sense, the pension reform now is going in exactly the wrong direction, destroying the long-term pension pillar, the invested pension pillar in favor of pay-as-you-go system. And that, of course, hurts businesses who are paying higher pension taxes and working middle class who's paying higher pension taxes and seeing nothing in return. So basically, a lot of people are saying Russian personal income tax is 13%. The honest answer now, no longer, in the sense that after some income, middle class has to pay 10% of marginal pension tax, which they will not see back ever as pension, because pensions are capped from above. So it's now at least 23% of income tax. And things like that are happening in recent years. There is a redistribution away from middle class to the poor, and that's why middle class is disinvesting and in some cases leaving. So that is my perception, but we'll see.
So middle class
will pay, yeah, because it's small and cannot take to the street and fight the populace. Yeah, there are always plans, Everybody wants to diversify. So once actually I was in a panel with Mr. Putin and asked him, what is in this 10 years, that was I think 2010 or 2011, what is something that you wanted to achieve 10 years ago but didn't achieve? He said, diversification, something I wanted to achieve and didn't achieve. Okay? And there are, in every program that I mentioned, there is a program for diversification. I think it's not the most important problem in the sense that we know oil-rich Norway, we know Australia, Canada, countries you can live in. And actually, US now produces, as you rightly said, US now, due to shale, produces more gas. And now, this year, US produces more oil than Russia. And still, it's a country with a functioning democracy. There are different views around this, but more functioning democracies than Russia. And then the question is, how these guys in the government foresee the reaction to oil price shock going down, negative oil price shock? I've asked this question many times. And so I was told by a very high-ranking government official that we'll get out somehow, we'll get away. You threatened us, you scared us many times with the negative oil price shock, and so far you were wrong. Whenever we need it, oil price goes up, not down. And scientifically, I cannot argue with that, right? Scientifically, they're right. All the observations are lined up. Whenever Mr. Putin needs oil price to go up, it goes up. And it will take just one different observation when oil price goes down and it doesn't go up when he needs it, and we'll see no Mr. Putin. But so far, I think his regression works better than mine. Okay? And so in that sense, I think there is this intrinsic belief that somehow God is on their side and they will get through somehow. But rationally, I would say that if oil price goes down to, say, $60 per barrel and stays there, in 2 years, there'll be a political change because all the money will be gone in 2 years. It's a very good question. I know Mike McFaul very well, and I respect him a lot. And I think reset actually worked until 2012. So the idea of reset was we have some differences, but let's work on things where it's a win-win situation. And that was a completely new approach because Russian diplomacy is usually based on the way that whatever is bad for the United States is good for Russia. And this is what Mike Fall tried to challenge, and that was very fortunate timing because Mr. Medvedev wanted to build something which would differentiate him from Mr. Putin and his diplomacy. And he couldn't run the economy, he couldn't do other things, but he could say, US-Russia relationship is my niche. And they together delivered. They delivered on many things. Russia joined WTO, there was a set of sanctions on Iran. There was a number of issues that helped US troops in Afghanistan. So a lot of things have happened. And then when Putin comes back, there is a huge increase in anti-Americanism, and that very Mike McFaul happens to arrive at the very same time. And I tell him, you shouldn't be surprised. There is an election campaign. Mr. Putin will come to power, establish himself, and he will not need an external enemy anymore. Okay? And I was completely wrong, because looks like election is going on. We still need external enemy every month. And moreover, we need more enemies. In addition to US, we now don't like Europeans who support gay marriage. We don't like foreign NGOs, once again, a lot, and so on and so forth. And the reason for that is Mr. Putin understands now, after the protests and after Ukraine, very well that he's not going to be kicked out at the ballot box. He's going to be kicked out like in Ukraine when people take to the street. And for that, he needs to use all these tools I mentioned. Repression, propaganda, and things like that. And in that sense, I think right now, there is not big potential for reset. because we need enemies. But you see, sometimes it works out. So with Syria, it's kind of work in the right direction. So eventually, Mr. Putin is a very pragmatic person. If he sees something can work for him, he would use it.
One last question.
Very good question. I have a lot of Polish friends. Some of them were in the government at that time and later. And I also know Leszek pretty well. I think one of the problems 20 years ago was actually Leszek was much better educated and knew much more about economics and economic reform than Russian economic liberals. And recently we organized a conference between and brought East European reformers and also Russian reformers. And it was organized in a place where they used to meet in the end of 80s and 1990s. It was International Institute for Applied Systems Analysis in Austria. They apparently had their brainstormings about this. And they came back and traveled down the memory lane. And it was very clear that Russians were learning from Balcerovich. But it was also very clear that Russians didn't have enough integrity to remain a moral beacon, which I think in those issues is also very important. And what is going to happen, as I said, in the long run, I'm quite optimistic. The word liberal may mean many things, but I think there is no such thing as a curse of private property in Russia. If rule of law is established in Russia, Russian businessmen will prosper like they do in the US when they go to Silicon Valley, right? And there is no genetic aversion to markets, competition, and private property, I think.
Well, on this positive